Hi everyone, this is Christina with the first part of Texel Density in Blender. If you're asking yourself, what the heck is Texel Density, I'm sure you're not the only one, because you don't find a lot of information in general, and especially not for Blender. I'm pretty sure a lot of you already dealt with that issue, and just from your gut feeling did what was right. But really explaining what texel density is and why it is so important, at least if you want to work with clients or in a pipeline, you don't find a lot of information about that on YouTube. But there is one resource I really recommend. When you type in texel density on Google, at least for me, those major entries appear. This is from the Foundry, and that is more about the tools they use in Modo. These are the makers of Modo. I didn't find it very interesting for a Blender user, but this one, this is something, in my opinion, everybody should read. If you follow that link, you come to the ArtStation page of a senior level artist at Ubisoft, Leonardo Nietzsche. I hope I pronounced that name right. I could have made good use of it 10 years ago. It was released 3 years ago. Really great stuff. And in most of the part of this PDF, here is a link to Gumroad where you can download that PDF for free, because that is a bit hard to read here. But most of this is about the common concept, what texel density is, and so on. And here you can see the scene. You can see those assets don't have the same scale of the texture, you could say so. And that is not how it should look in a scene when you're working on a pipeline. You want something like this, where we have an equal distribution of the scale of the textures. And that is what texel density is about. But on YouTube, I have the search results for texel density in common here. There are some videos for Blender 2.8. This is by Luis Cherubini. He explains how that add-on I use work. This one I watched yesterday, to be honest. This is only 3 months old, and this guy, and I believe he is a professional, is still eyeballing texel density nowadays in Blender. In my opinion, that's not the right way to go. But anyway, and this is only about one object, not how you match up different objects. This playlist, I didn't look into it. This one shows a render, how a render with a grid looks like when you used the texel density correctly. I didn't look into this one. This is a Modo one. This one touches the basics quite good, was interesting to watch. But there's no in-depth explanation what texel density really is. Yeah, and those other ones are also not what we want to see. And everything else is just related to my search. Because UV editing and texel density are related. So not a lot of information at all. And when I do the same search in addition with Blender here, you somehow see pop up the same videos. This, by the way, is by the developer of the texel density checker. We will have a closer look at that add-on, which is free, in the next video. But otherwise, we don't have a lot of information about that topic. Why is that so important? You might say, well, I'm just an enthusiast. This is a hobby for me. Why should I care about texel density? What is it? Texel density kind of does the same for a 3D model what the resolution in a 2D image does for the image. In an image, the smallest unit you have is a pixel, and that is a fixed component that might look different depending on your display when it comes to the size or to the color. But it is a fixed component. Texel, which stands for texture elements, that is shortened, it is a made-up word, kind of does the same for our 3D object. but a texel is just a container for the amount of texture resolution we see. Sounds really confusing, doesn't it? We will have a look into that in Blender. Why should you care about that when you only do private projects? I will show you a still from a YouTube video which is about texel density in 3ds Max. So the rest of the video didn't interest me, but I was intrigued by the thumbnail, because in the thumbnail you see this tablecloth, and that red dot on there is a can, a soda can. That was the way I clicked that video. You can also see that preview here, and that is this here. And if I now click this, it should be immediately visible for everybody. There is something wrong. Look at that. That is a still, and I link to this video in the description below because I used this still image. You can watch it yourself. What is off? Well, you might simply say the resolution of the two textures is off, and that's correct. Here we see that can with the text even visible here in the video. You can read it here what it says. Not pixelated at all, and this can is standing on this tablecloth or whatever it is, and immediately you can see the quality. The resolution between the two textures doesn't match at all. The tablecloth is blurred, pixelated, it looks horrible, and this is crystal clear. So everybody, even somebody without 3D experience, sees something is off, and that is how the texture is shown. You might now say, well, the resolution of this texture from the tablecloth isn't high enough, but that doesn't have to be the case at all. Maybe that tablecloth texture has an even higher resolution than the one from the can. I doubt it in this case, but that could be. And still we are seeing it in a very bad resolution here, pixelated. That might be the case because the tablecloth has a really low texel density, while the can obviously have a very high texel density. That texel density, what is that about? And how does that look in Blender? Let's go there. A simple 5, I used that in my number series. What we can see immediately is that the texture doesn't show up the same. It looks different. It looks almost, this is another texture. The checkers are much smaller. We see a lot more of them, but it is the same material. It is exactly the same texture in the same resolution. Just this island from this front surface has another texel density. We will come back to that. Let's make a new scene. And I go into top view and add a plane. Which is in general 2x2 meter. I set it to 1 meter. Because when it comes to texel density, you might get requests from a client where they tell you, hey, we need that sci-fi container you did in the foreground in a texel density 20.48, and for the background in a texel density 5.12. And you should know what that client is talking about. And as we've seen in that video still here, that could happen everywhere, even in a private project. And if you know how to deal with that and what texel density is, yeah, that is the right way to go. So this plane has no material yet. Let's add one, and I call this 512, and I will use an image texture which we don't have yet. Let's set this to texture here. That's okay. I will generate 3 different color grid textures. Color grid comes with Blender, and we will generate a 512 by 512, 1024 by 1024, and the next size will be 2048 by 2048. But first let's go in and let's duplicate this. And that is how we dealt with texel density in Blender for years, because Blender still has no native tools. Today is the 3rd February 2020. Blender 2.8.2 will be released next week on Thursday if everything goes like planned. So it's only 1.5 weeks away, and still that new version will not have any native tools for texel density, and that is where Blender really has to step up its game, because that is a huge part missing which is needed in the industry. Nowadays we have two add-ons which we can use. The text tools was the first one, as far as I know, and then following it was the texel density checker we saw on that video list on YouTube. I used the text tools for years to do texel density directly in Blender, but it is a bit tedious, I would say it so, because you only can use it in edit mode. I still use it for other tasks, but not for the texel density, because the texel density checker also works in object mode and is much easier to use than the text tools. But anyway, we have add-ons and both are free, so you don't have to pay them if you don't want to. But what we see here, that was the only way to match the texel density, because Blender has no native tools to do it, so you had to eyeball it. That was the only way to go. And that is what Leonardo also stated in his document here, if you scroll way down. Manual, it works always. And yes, it always works to do that manually. You just have to eyeball it as best as you could. It is tedious and time consuming. And that is what we used those planes for years back. We had the layer system in Blender, not the collection system like we have now. We had that layer system, and I always put 3 of those planes, 1 by 1 meter, on an extra layer, just to use them to match my texel density. So what's that about? If you go to CG Textures, which is one of the oldest, if not the oldest, archive platform for CG artists to get textures. If I go into the 3D scanned materials here with most of those things, when I go in there, you can see 1 by 1 or 2 by 2 meters. And if I scroll down, I come to the flat maps. Those are the flat maps for 1 by 1 meter. And if we have an area 1 by 1 meter and put on 512 by 512 on that whole area, so that covers exactly that 1 by 1 meter, then we are talking about a texel density for this area by 512 pixels per meter, or 5.12 pixels per centimeter. For those of you not familiar with the metric system, 1 meter is 100 centimeter. And by the way, I have US clients, none of them ever asked me to do the texel density in inches. None of them. Inches are common when we are working on 2D images in Photoshop or something like that. Totally common to use 72 dots per inches or pixels per inches, or 300 for prints. But in 3D, it is much more common to use texel density in values pixels per meter or pixels per centimeter. And much more common is the per centimeter. So most of your clients will ask, for example, texel density 5.12 per centimeter or 512 per meter. And that is what we get when we take a texture like this, which is for 1 by 1 meter in this resolution, and throw it on our plane here. Well, with this texture here, you wouldn't see a huge difference. Where we see the difference for sure is when we generate color grids and they come with Blender. That's really easy to do. I will throw in such an image here in our material, which I named 512. You can do that in Texture Paint. I prefer to use the UV editing workspace. I go to sync mode. So what I've selected here, which is one face here, that plane only has one face, and that is covering the whole area 1 by 1 meter. That grid you see here behind, that isn't a texture at all. That is our UV space 0 to 1. And I often see in tutorials on YouTube people scaling over the border of that UV area. If you're only working with Blender and if you don't use UDIM textures, which we have new in 2.8.2 anyway, if you don't use them and if you're only working with Blender and set your texture to repeat, that's totally fine. If you're working with clients, never do something like that. Never ever. This UV island, which is only one face, is now larger than our UV space. You don't know if your customer is working with an app which can't deal with that. And even if he or she tells you, hey, I'm using that software, you might not know how that software is working with such things, and they might change the software tomorrow and your assets should still work. So never ever do that. To get back, I just unwrap this again and I'm back to this. So this grid we see here is not our texture. I go to new, type in 512, because we are generating our 512 texture. If you don't want to type the numbers, you can let Blender do the math. It calculates that for you. I uncheck the alpha, we don't need that, and I go to color grid here and click OK. And now we see that color grid, how it looks like with the resolution, image resolution 512 by 512. We don't see it here because it isn't in our material. I go back to layout mode. First thing I do is check if I have the light matcap and texture checked here. And then I click here by base color on that circle, go to image texture, and now this field appears, and here I can choose my texture I just generated. This is rotated, but yes, you can see it on all three because I just copied that, so they all use the same material. For this one here, I unwrapped it again, and sometimes Blender rotates the island here. I can just rotate this by 180 degrees and it's in the right direction again. They are all three using this texture now. They are all three set to this material. I click here and generate one 1024, and also here, because I'm lazy, I let Blender do the calculations for me. And click OK again. This isn't connected to the material, and I don't do that right now. I first generate the third one, which is 2048. And I have my third texture. What I do now, I go back to layout mode. I click this here, and for this one I generate a new material by clicking this icon here. I rename it, can do that here, and here I choose this texture to use it, and this one also gets a new material, which we call 2048. And of course here I choose the correlating texture we generated. That's what we have by now. Let's save this. And what we did in the past was generating something like that. And when my client came in and said, okay, I need the TD 5.12. I know that is this one, and then I scaled the UVs till it looked kind of the same like this in the size on my object. That's how we did it back then. But scaling UVs can be dangerous. You shouldn't do that over the borders of your UV space, you know that. I just told you so. So sometimes you have to do more seams or tell your client, hey, I have to use a larger texture. You often get limits for the texture, and for game engines that might still be 512. For other projects, we are working with textures of 2048, 4096 for advertisements and movies, that goes way, way higher. But in general, 2K and 4K are common, but that is something your customer has to tell you, as well as the TD, the texel density he needs his objects in. When a customer requests a sci-fi container and tells me he needs two very different TDs, I know, okay, the lower TD is for the background and the high TD is for the foreground object. And it might be that you have to do the work twice because you have to fit in other objects on the same texture often and have to fiddle around with the islands then. But yeah, that's not that bad if you know how to deal with. We've seen on our 5, let me save this again and change to the other scene, that we have a total different resolution. What is shown, the amount from the texture is shown, that is much higher here than here. Where does that come from? Let's have a closer look at that. I generate a new plane. I could copy one of those and then just scale it and apply the scale, but I prefer to do it here so I don't forget the scale command. And I will grab this and pull it directly under here, and then I go in Shift D, make my copies. And I don't name those planes here. I don't care if they are in the right order or something like that. I know here is my 512 material, and I put the same material on this one here. So I go in here and choose this from the list. And you can immediately see that now looks much smaller than we had it with this one here. And that is because when we go into the UV editing and I delete this one here, or let's just grab the 512. This is this UV. This one face takes up the whole UV area, the whole UV space here, and that means it takes up the whole texture. But the object, one edge is only 60 centimeters long. This UV face does exactly the same. When I change to that, that doesn't change here. It shows the texture all over our UV face, but this is 1 meter long. So you could say with this one here, the texture is kind of squished in a smaller area. And that is the very same when we do the same thing for the other ones. And what we see here is just what I choose here. I can delete that completely, that doesn't matter. I can also use my checker map here. That only shows me a texture here in the UV space. That doesn't mean that is really connected to our object, so I can just delete it. And if I go in here and choose this and go in here and choose this one, you see the same happens. If I would scale this up to 1 by 1 meter, we would have exactly the same size. Or if I would scale this one, and we can do that, scale this down, and you see it now looks exactly the same like this one here. So the size of my object directly influences how much or how large the texture is shown, or the other way around, the texel density tells me which amount of my texture is shown in 1 centimeter or 1 meter, which means that has to be another texel density like this one. And if we go to the texel density checker now, you see this is always starting with 512. When I call the add-on, I have to tell the add-on which texture I'm using. This one is the 512, so this matches. And if I now go in here and say calculate TD, watch what happens here. This now says 5.119, so 5.12. If I do the same here, you can see that is another amount. That isn't the same texel density. And if we go to this one here, where I can really scroll in very close till it gets blurry, and even more here, because this texture is now on a smaller surface. But if I go in here, go to edit mode, so I see this here, and now just scale this down very small, we see it like this. And I guess it now is clear why that happens. But coming back to this here, where I said that doesn't necessarily mean the table gloss has a texture with a low resolution, it just shows the texture in a low resolution. This is exactly the same texture like here, 248 by 248. It is exactly the same texture, but if I scroll in here and if I go into full window mode, I can even scroll in closer. This could be my Ken with a high texel density, and here the same texture looks really horrible, really bad. But it is the same material, the same texture, it just the texel density doesn't show as much of the texture like here. And you always have to keep that in mind. If I now go to my number scene, now we've seen how that add-on works. Now I can tell Blender in edit mode, not in object mode, but in edit mode. And let's go back to the previous here. If I select my island here, you see I have the texel density checker also here for the UV. So I can go in here, select that island here, and say, hey, calculate the TD. And this is now a very odd number. I say, okay, set this as my value. And then I click this island here and say, set my TD. And now we're back on the same size for the checkers. And that is a huge help when you're working with textures, with the texel density, because with native tools you can't do that. I would have to unwrap all the other parts again, which maybe when I, let's say I grabbed this island here and moved it to a better place and did manual painting on that. So I painted something on this and that shouldn't go lost. And I now want to scale this back. I just can set my TD and that doesn't move the other islands here. And that is a huge advantage of this add-on. And we will have a closer look in this add-on, how to work with, when to use it in edit mode, when to use it in object mode. What you should consider about those texture sizes here, we will have a closer look into that in the next video, where I will show you a beach umbrella and a beach chair, which we will do in one of the future videos, where we will model those two different objects modeled separately, and then we have to match the 2D and things like that. Different materials also, and that will be not as dry and boring like this. Yeah, but you have to know what the 2D is about, and now you got the first clue. That's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. If you like my contents, please consider subscribing to the channel if you already did. Thank you very much. Hopefully see you in the next video. Till then, have a great time. Bye bye.